Hello students, today our lesson is lesson number 3, labor, and like I told you in the previous video of the same lesson that I have divided the lesson into two parts. So this is the second part of the lesson. Now, the second part we are going to discuss more and more about the division of labor, okay? And now before we get into details of division of labor, we must know its meaning. Therefore, what is division of labor? Now, division of labor means to assign different works of a manufacturing process to different people. Okay, so when different people are given different works, different tasks, that is division of labor. Okay, and division of labor can also be known as specialization of labor. So it's if in the question it comes define specialization of labor, you have to write what is division of labor. So they are the same thing. Okay, and if you look into your textbooks on page number 28, you are going to find two definitions over there. One is given by A.H. Smith and the second one is given by Penguin Dictionary of Economics. And I would like you to please write both the definitions in your registers as well as learn both of them. Okay, and this will help you to write and learn, and therefore after writing and learning you will be able to remember the definition better. But just the general know-how of what division of labor is, it is the assigning of different tasks to different people. And what kind of tasks? Tasks related to manufacturing process. Let's move on. We are going to study about the types of division of labor. There are various kinds of division of labor. Therefore, let's look into them. The first one is the product-based division of labor. Okay. Now, product-based division of labor is also known as simple, personal or occupational division of labor. And we will also talk about process-based division of labor, which is also known as complex division of labor. So first let's see what is product based. Okay, now when people around us can be divided, okay, people around us can be divided into different categories. For example, let's say a teacher, a doctor, a farmer, or maybe a weaver. So according to their respective occupations they will be divided. Now if my qualification is to be a teacher, I cannot be divided into the category of a doctor. Why? Because I am not skilled to do that, right? Therefore, I will, according to my occupation, I will be kept into the category. Okay, so this type of division is called the simple or the occupational, or we can also say the product based division of labor, in which people are actually specialized in a particular kind of an occupation. Now, I am specialized to be a teacher, I cannot become a lawyer. Or if I am a specialized teacher, I am specialized to be a teacher, I cannot go and work in a hospital as a nurse or a doctor. Okay? So, when work is divided according to the occupation of a person, according to the type of occupation, that is called product-based division of labor. Or you can also call it as simple, personal or occupational division of labor. The next we are going to look into is complex or process based division of labor. Now, the total work is actually divided into many small processes. Okay, and each function or each divided function or specialized function is taken by an individual. Every individual or group of individuals are going to do that task. And what is the aim? It is leading to a final product. So this is like a system that takes place. So in this process based system, there is something to do about the process. Process from converting the goods into a final product. Okay. So there are two categories that we have to understand in this. The first one is the complete process of complex division of labor, or complete process of process division of labor. So what is the complete process? Now, production process is divided into different stages, okay, so that the product developed in each stage is used to produce the product of the next stage. Now, let's take an example. Let's say the jobs done in industry and apparel industry, one worker cuts the cloth. Okay, the other person is going to definitely stitch the cloth with the help of machinery. Okay, and there will be another worker to fold the clothes, and there will be someone who is going to do the final packing of the clothing. So this is a complete process. Are you understanding? So when a process takes place completely, fully done to the final product, that is the complete process of complex division of labor. The second stage that you are going to see will be found to be on page number 30, that is incomplete process of complex division of labor. Now in this, what happens, the work is divided into different processes and also sub processes in order to produce a part of a component. Okay, so basically what happens here is that we are not producing the final product here. Okay, let's take an example that the different parts of an automobile are incomplete parts unless until they are assembled together to produce the complete car. Okay, so the final product is car, but at the first stage, what are you doing? You're actually assembling them together. So that will be called as the incomplete process. Okay, now let's move on to the next category, that is the horizontal and vertical division of labor. Now horizontal division of labor can be done by dividing the production process in different parts so that each stage of production runs simultaneously. So what does that mean? This means that the workers engaged in producing different parts of an automobile will be considered as horizontal division of labor. Why? Because they are systematically, horizontally, they are moving from one stage to the other, then assembling the next part, then assembling the next part. So this will be considered as the horizontal division of labor. So basically in this process, what is happening, the different parts of an automobile can be manufactured. Okay, so simultaneously what is happening, on one hand production or manufacturing of the automobile parts is taking place, and simultaneously they are being assembled. So a part is getting ready and it's being assembled, another part is getting ready, it's being assembled. So this simultaneous work will be horizontal division of labor. The next one is vertical division of labor. Now vertical division of labor can be done by dividing the production process into successive stages. Now let's take an example. In order to produce textiles, raw materials such as cotton, wool or silk has to be converted into yarn by spinning. After that, the yarn is used to weave the cloth. And the process of spinning and weaving cannot be performed on the same bag of raw material simultaneously. The fiber is first spun and then the thread is used to weave the cloth. Therefore, a vertical division of labor is needed in the textile industry. So if we look into the textile industry, you can't work horizontally. It's not about manufacturing a part and then simultaneously assembling it as well. This cannot happen in vertical. What happens in vertical is that first thing first. Okay, so first you must have your raw materials. Then you convert them into yarns by spinning them. Then first the fiber is first spun, and after spinning them, the thread is used to weave the cloth. So a process is taking place here, but there is nothing that is happening simultaneously. Okay. There's nothing that is happening one after the other. Yani ki ek ke jaise automobile industry mein pehle part bana rahe hain aur usko saath ke saath assemble bhi kar rahe hain. This situation is not taking place in vertical labor division of labor. Okay. Now next we are going to look into the international and national division of labor. So let's see international. Now countries, basically you have to understand that countries have very scarce and limited resources. Okay, so they cannot produce everything that a citizen requires. Okay, if I want to consume, it's not possible for my country workers to produce every single thing that I desire and I want to consume. Okay, so countries produce only those goods and services for which they have sufficient resources. and those products through which they can earn profits, good profits, which are advantageous. Okay, so they are going to only produce those. Now what happens is that countries prefer to import goods and services from other countries. Therefore, the difference in availability of resource leads to a division of labor between countries. So what happens is, now countries concentrate on the production of the goods and services for which they have enough resources. The product for which they have enough raw materials and resources, that they are going to produce more. Okay, and the products and services that are the raw materials and resources that are not abundantly available for a particular product, that thing they are going to import from some other country. So let's take an example over here. Like in your book it's given, Japan and South Korea produce more of technologically advanced goods as they are capital intensive economies. While if you see the Caribbean countries, they produce more of agricultural goods because they are labor intensive economies. So this will be international division of labor, that a part of the world is doing technically advanced commodities, one part of the world is doing agricultural commodities. Okay, so this will be international division of labor. Next is national division of labor. Now in this what happens, let's take an example in India only. Several jute mills are concentrated in the eastern part of the country, while some cotton mills are located in the western and southern parts of the country. So this will be region-wise division. Now this is not country-wise division of labor, but this is regions within one country. So if the southern and the southern and the western part of India are into cotton mills, so the eastern part of India is into the jute mills. Okay, so region-wise distribution of work, this will be national division of labor. The next one is territorial or geographical division of labor. Now sometimes what happens, there are some diverse reasons. So the production of goods is focused at a state or nation. So what happens, the focus of producing and the production process is focused or concentrated to a particular state or a particular country. So this specific type of division of labor comes into being when the workers or factories having experts in the production of specific article are found at a specific place. For example, let's take an example. Cotton textiles are in Ahmedabad and Mumbai jute industry in Kolkata. So now this is a geographical division of labor. That means in Ahmedabad there are cotton textiles, so they are focused on that. Okay, and industry in Kolkata and Mumbai, they are focused, industries in Kolkata are focused more on more about jute. Okay, so the division of labor concentrated into a particular state or a nation, that will be territorial or geographical division of labor. Okay, that means in a particular territory, in a particular geographical place. Okay, now let's move on into the lesson and we are going to see further. But before that, on page number 31, if you turn your books to page 31, you will find that there is a table. The table has 5 points and it is a table of difference between product and process based division of labor. And I would like you all to not only learn this table but also write it in your register. Okay, right. Now as we move on, we are going to see the advantages of division of labor. And the advantages of division of labor are actually divided in 4 parts. Okay, so producers are benefited, workers are benefited, consumers are benefited, and also the society is benefited. Now what we are going to see is, the first one that we are going to see are the benefits to the producers. Now let's see the first point of how producers are being benefited with the help of division of labor. Now the first point is increase in production. What happens here is that when specialization or division of labor is done, the workers are quite efficient, skilled and equipped. They become very equipped, they become skilled and they become very efficient. Now what happens is that they acquire a higher speed in work. They become more fast in doing their work. They become quicker in doing their work. Now this ultimately leads to a situation where the production can be more. So that means more number of commodities can be produced. And when more commodities can be produced, in such a case, the producers are easily able to earn more and more profit. The next benefit is improvement in the quality. Now, earlier we saw the quantity of the goods increases. Secondly, we see that the quality of the goods also increase. And when the the worker becomes very efficient in work, he is able to produce a good quality of commodities. Now this good quality of commodities helps the producers again to earn a good amount of profit. The next point is introduction to machines. Now what happens is that the workers become skilled. Okay, so when the workers are skilled and they are able to use the machinery, they are able to, after the introduction of machinery, they are able to handle the machinery, then what happens is that such production that is taking place out of new machinery and introduction of machinery, the products are standardized. Okay, they are produced in a standard form, and this helps to achieve higher production and ultimately leading to earning profits. And profits can always benefit the producers. The next point is new innovation. Now what happens is when division of labor takes place, one worker has to do less work. Okay, and he is more, he has to work only on one kind of a machine and has to work in one kind of a situation, one kind of a task. So therefore he has enough time while doing his job, he has enough time to think freely. And when the worker has enough time to think freely, that is the time when the worker can actually think about new ideas. Okay, and new ideas can come to the minds of the workers, which sometimes results into new inventions also. And thus the producers, through these new inventions are able to produce better goods and they are able to earn more profit. Our last benefit that we are going to see for the producers is employment of unskilled labor. Now what happens, because the work is simplified because of the division of labor, what happens is that the work is from a complex situation, the work becomes into a simple process. Okay, so work is totally divided and it's like less work on each person, and now even the less skilled people can easily work. Why? Because they don't, maybe, see, we have to understand that the workers are given work according to their occupation, their type of occupation. So if a person is very skilled and very trained and very equipped, will not be given a work which an unskilled person should be doing. So, and on the other hand, an unskilled will not get the work that a skilled person should be doing, right? Therefore what we have to understand is that the production of goods can be produced also by the less equipped and less skilled people or the workers at lower wages. Okay, and thus this will lead to employment in the country. Now we are going to move on into our next topic, that is the advantages of division of labor to the workers. Now what happens is that there are certain points that we are going to go through, and we are going to see that what happens to the workers when division of labor is done. The first point is right man for right work. That means in this type of division of labor, the job is given to different people who are suited for that particular work. Okay, so who is eligible to do a particular work is given that task. Now what happens is that the division of labor allows the best use of worker skills and provides the job satisfaction to the worker. Now if me being a teacher, if I am given the work to do the work of a doctor to do, I will not be able to do that work because I'm not skilled and I'm not the right person for that kind of a work. Also, when I will somehow manage doing that work, I will not have the job satisfaction. But if I am a teacher and I'm working as a teacher, I am the right person for the right task. Therefore, what happens is that I will get the job satisfaction also. and I will prove myself much more efficiently as compared to me working in some different field that is not according to my occupation. Next is increased efficiency. Now, when a worker is given a work, a task, okay, it leads to higher efficiency. So the idea behind division of labor is to make sure that workers become masters in their job. Okay, they become very well equipped and skilled in their job. So when workers are assigned these tasks, they tend to become efficient, and gradually in that particular task they will become master. Okay, so this division of labor leads to efficiency in the labor. Next is less time for finishing a task. Now, when division of labor is done, it allows the workers to finish their work in limited time, in very less time. Okay, so they don't take all the time, but within some time they are able to finish the work, and then they can move on into the next process. The next point is reduced stress. Now, when workers undertake a part of the work, that means they are given the divided work, they become accustomed to their job. They are very regular to their job. They know what to do. So this means that they are not doing something new and something for the first time. They are quite equipped in that particular field, and therefore they are every day doing the same work, which means that they will not have much mental and physical stress. And the last benefit that we are going to see for the workers is higher employment opportunities. Now, this kind of division of labor leads to higher variety of number of jobs. So basically what happens is that a large number of large scale and small scale industries can be set up, and when large scale and such industries are set up, then there is rapid industrialization, and when there is rapid industrialization, automatically employers are needed, and therefore what happens is that the employer employs many people under him and can let the people work in different large scale as well as small scale industries, and this will lead to a lot of employment. And when there is a lot of employment, the workers are going to be benefited because they are going to start earning, and when they are going to start earning, it will be beneficial for them. The next is benefits to the consumer. Now, with the help of division of labor, consumers are also benefited. Let's see how. The first is availability of cheaper goods. Now, what happens? Division of labor helps in the large scale production of almost all types of goods and services. Now, when all types of goods and services are being produced, this leads to external and internal economies of scale in this production process and a reduced cost of production. So what is happening here is that the retailer can sell goods at lower rates. Okay, the seller and wholesaler, retailers, they can sell goods at lower rates. Also, less cost of production will be used, and the goods will become cheaper. Why? Because the task has been divided to different people. So the cost of production is going to be less. And when the cost of production is less, it automatically leads to cheaper goods. Next is large varieties of goods. What happens is that when division of labor has made takes place, it has made it possible to manufacture at cheaper rates. Okay, so the products require higher skill. Now let's take an example. A car is now being conveniently produced by making the appropriate division of labor, in which many simplified jobs are being done by less skilled or unskilled labor at cheaper rates. As there was no division of labor in the past, many of the commodities were available at a very higher price, okay, to the complex process or production. Only the rich people could afford those. Now, what is happening? Now, the variety of goods are becoming larger. Earlier, what was happening, when there was no division of labor, the process was very complex, okay? And what was happening? That the commodities were available at higher prices. But since the division of labor has taken place, the commodities are being available at lower rates. And when they are being available at lower rates, automatically now not only rich, but everyone can afford it. So now there is a variety of goods that is available in the market, and it's easy for the consumers because now every kind of a consumer can buy. It's not only for the elite class, but it's also for every kind of a class. That means rich, poor, both can afford it. The next is improved standard of living. Now we have to understand that when consumers can easily afford things at cheaper rates, then they can choose the goods and all to consume from varieties of goods. Okay, and from varieties of goods, when they are choosing, they will choose those goods, they will consume those goods which can satisfy their needs. Okay, so this kind of a consumption pattern where the things are available at cheaper rates, they can choose also, and the goods and services are easily available and they are being satisfied, this kind of a consumption pattern in the society, it leads to a good standard of living. So they are able to afford things at cheaper rates, they are able to choose out of many things, they are able to consume many things, and they, not only that, they are also satisfied when they are buying things. So that leads to improved standard of living. The last thing that we are going to see are the benefits or advantages to the society. How is the society as a whole being benefited? So the first benefit is faster economic development. Now see, the division of labor actually allows the optimum utilization of the factors of production and things like raw materials, you have your transportation, capital, communication facilities, banking facilities. These are all factors of production. Okay, so optimum use of such factors of production or things that can be used for the purpose of production can be optimally utilized. Okay, like the best utilization can be done. So what happens when this takes place, this optimum utilization of factors of production takes place in the division of labor, new employment opportunities are generated. Why? Now, for example, raw materials is one factor, transport is another, capital is another, means of communication, banking services. Different kinds of people are to be employed at different places. For transportation facility, you can't be appointing a banker, right? So, for banking services, you will appoint bankers. Okay, for communication facilities, you will have the different set of people working. For transport, you will have different set of people working. So in every factor of production, there will be different set of people working. And to have so many people, automatically employment is needed. Like employment, the space of employment has to be, the gap of employment has to be filled. And therefore, the generation of new opportunities will arise, which also allows the less skilled to work. Okay, in some kind of a job they can also work. So what happens is that this kind of increase in employment opportunity leads to the development and growth of industries and regional economic development as well. Therefore, what happens that society as a whole is benefited, that economy grows faster, okay, economy develops faster. On the other hand, employment is also generated and it benefits the industries, it benefits the entire society and economy. The next point is increased number of entrepreneurs. Now entrepreneurs are essential for organizing and coordinating the jobs. Okay, so who are entrepreneurs exactly? They are the economic agents. Okay, they are economic agents who actually are the boss, in other words, in very simple words, if you see, entrepreneurs are the bosses who divide the work among workers. So to reap the benefits of the division of labor, the production process and activities they are performed by every labor, and that needs to be very well organized. That needs to be very well organized in a manner where qualified people are doing their set of job, trained people are doing their set of job. Okay, so the division of labor encourages new productive units and industries also. So when new units will be set up, new industries will be set up, then that will lead to more and more trained and qualified managers and organizers. So more industries, more units of production, more places of work, more workers needed, then therefore ultimately there will be a need of many entrepreneurs, many new organizers and managers and administrators. Okay, so from the society, who all are trained and equipped to become entrepreneurs can come into this work, into the new units of production. So ultimately, who is being benefited? The society, because all the people in the society who are eligible to be entrepreneurs or to be organizers or managers, then they can come into this sector and they can be a part of the production unit. Okay, now we are also going to look into the disadvantages of division of labor. So the first disadvantage is monotony of work. Basically, what happens, a worker is given a particular task to do. Okay, so that person is stuck up in that task for a long time, and because that person is stuck up over there, the zeal of working diminishes, the interest starts coming down. So basically, to avoid this kind of a monotony of work, there should be a proper planning of constant shifting of workers from one task to another. Okay, the next point is loss of creativity. Now what happens is that an entire product is not being created and produced by one worker. Many workers are involved in producing one single commodity. Therefore what happens is that feeling of pride, or that feeling of, you know, sense of pleasure and creativity is lost among the workers, because they feel that, oh, we haven't even put much effort, because every single person was working behind bringing the final product. Okay, so basically that creativity is lost, and in other words, we can also say that the person remains very unsatisfied, because that person is not getting to produce the entire commodity. He's just producing a single part of the commodity. Okay, the next point is lack of responsibility. Now here what happens is that the work is divided among so many people. Now if there is any defect in the commodity, who is responsible for this? You can't be blaming it at a particular person. Okay, because so many people are involved. Therefore there is lack of responsibility also. So nobody is responsible for the defect in it. Next is excessive interdependence. Now there is too much dependence of the workers among each other, onto each other. Reason is that every worker is assigned a particular work. So if there are 10 workers and 10 tasks are given and a final product has to come out, for that final product to come out, if even one stops working, the product will not be coming out. So too much dependence on each other is there. Okay, so any problem or any kind of defect in one part of the commodity can cause disturbance in the entire process of production. The next point is class conflict. Now what happens is, class means there are two classes, rich and poor. Okay, so rich category is of the producers and poor category is of the low paid laborers or workers. So in division of labor, what happens is that who is doing all the hard work? The workers are doing all the hard work. And who is getting the benefits of the hard work? The producers are getting the benefits. Okay, they are earning big profits. And this kind of profits, they are keeping it to themselves. And they turn out to become very rich because of the high profits that they earn. But the workers, they are low paid, they are very, less paid, and they remain poor. And this kind of a situation where poor remains poor and the producers keep becoming rich, or they keep gradually moving towards the richer side, both of these classes make efforts to safeguard their interests now. Okay, so in the process of safeguarding their own interests, there are conflicts with each other. So this kind of conflict, the class conflict between rich and poor, can lead to less harmony and disturbance in the entire process. And the last point is lack of mobility. In this, what happens is that the workers are fixed to one kind of a work for their entire life, almost entire life. Okay, so what happens is that they are stuck up in this production process, so they don't have much chance to move or change their workplace. They don't really get many other opportunities. Also, one reason of not getting many other opportunities is because they are mostly not very skilled. Okay, and others might not take them. Therefore, there's lack of mobility. They feel, okay, we are stuck here means we are stuck here. They continue being there. And because that kind of a thinking of theirs is present in their mind, that, okay, we've got this particular task, we have to do it, and they will keep doing it for their whole life, they don't think about moving from one place to another. So there is lack of mobility also because of division of labor. So I hope, children, you've understood the lesson, and this is quite simple, and I hope you will follow it in your book as well. Kindly write the process based and product based division of labor difference in your notebook, and not only write it, but please learn the points, all the points, properly. Thank you.